We've got the amazing Jerry Ordway on with us. We'll be talking all about the death of Superman, the 30th anniversary. We've also got Larry Quiggins, owner of Bugs Comics and Games, and we'll be talking with him. And we'll be giving away a poly bag, 30th anniversary, death of Superman. All that and more. Stand by.
We're talking TV, comics and movies, and video games. And if you don't know Star Trek from Star Wars, we'll try to explain. There are 12 doctors, 4 Hogwarts houses, 1 ring rules and more. To be the greatest Pokemon master, you must catch them all. You must catch them all. Try to catch.
If you're driving around the greater St. Louis area tonight, listening to us on the big 550 KTRS, hello to all of you. Thank you very much for listening. If you're hearing us after the fact in the podcast form, we appreciate your finding us there and subscribing and listening. And if you're watching us on YouTube, we've got Joey V in the house, my executive producer, so we've got video tonight. Hello to all of you watching on Facebook and YouTube and wherever else you might be streaming us from. This is the 30th anniversary of the death of Superman, which doesn't seem possible because we had that phantom decade that I always call the 2000 to 2010, where it's like someone says something happened in 1990. I'm like, oh, that was just 10 years. Oh, no, it wasn't. That was actually 30 years ago now. It sneaks up on you. But we've got Larry and Jerry both in the house. We're going to be talking about Jerry's work. Let me start with Jerry. We were talking, Larry and I were talking before the show started. And you were like, you were writing and drawing, but we couldn't remember the sequence. Because I know you started drawing with Marv Wolfman was the writer for Adventures of Superman 424. And then if I'm not mistaken, you were writing and Janky was drawing, but was he just inking and you were drawing and writing at that point? I can't remember how it all went, how it started.
Well, I started with working on Adventures for about a year, and then I worked with Byrne for about a year, and then I took over writing on Adventures of Superman and drawing it. After I did the Batman movie comic, I switched did that for a while, and then I switched back when Tom Grummett was drawing Adventures of Superman, and we did that for quite a while, like through the death of and leading into the death of Superman. Dennis Jenkins place in history because he did a fill-in issue of Adventures of Superman that has the Doomsday Fist punching through the ground or whatever.
Yeah.
So Dennis's issue, the death of, except for that last page.
Huh.
And he basically he penciled and inked one full issue of Superman that sold, you know, like tremendously, mainly because he kind of lucked onto the beginning of, you know, the on or whatever the sales phenomenon.
And it was a huge thing. I know, like I said, we've got Larry Quiggins in the studio as well, owner of Bugs Comics and Games, and he's back with Bugs Comics and Games. When I was just a little kid, I would ride my bike up to Larry's store, and I would buy all these comic books, and I'd spend every single penny I made bussing tables to buy comic books. The sales numbers, from a store's perspective, that was a hot item. They didn't have, I don't think, people coming in to pre-order stuff like they do kind of now, where you get the previous catalog and you go through it. What were the sales like at the time?
Well, the sales, like you said, were phenomenal. But beforehand, there were customers who would turn in their previews and do pre-orders, but very little, nothing like it is nowadays. And I did have some who did previews, and they would say, oh, that's coming up, that looks cool, they order 2 or 3 copies or blah, 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 stuff like that. But nobody, and I'm sure Jerry would attest to that, nobody expected the news media to take the story and turn it into the story, almost the story of the century. And it just, then the layman, the non-comic book person, they had to have it because in their minds, Superman was going to die and never come back.
Right.
And if that were to happen, mind you, it would be a significant event. But we all in the comic world, we knew it's like, okay, yeah, well, this is cool. And then trying to help the public understand, but even so, they still never did. I mean, years later when they killed Captain America, the news media talked to me, and I'm trying to tell them, just like with Superman, he will be back. But they didn't want to hear that. It's, he's dead forever. It's like, so. But that is the one time I told you, remember, I went to the store because back in those days, we got delivery by truck because of the Sparta plant. And I'd meet the truck there at like 6 o'clock in the morning, do the books so it'd be open up for the new comic day on Wednesday. And I remember driving into the, because you know, you worked across the street from it, so where you used to ride your bike to and such. And I drove into the plaza there, and there's a long line of people standing in front of all the stores at 6 o'clock in the morning when nothing's open. And I'm thinking to myself, what are all these people here for? What are they here for? And I'm driving down, I pull in front of the store, and it's like, oh my God, they're starting the line in the door of my store at 6 o'clock in the morning. They're like, do you have the Death of Superman yet? I was like, well, the truck hasn't even showed up yet. And right then I knew, oh my God, this has gone crazy.
And I know this was obviously in the time before social media. We didn't have Twitter and Instagram and Facebook and things like that in 93. Were you surprised by, I mean, not maybe you personally, but was DC Comics even taken aback by the amount of press this received, Jerry?
Yeah, they. I think it started building right, I guess, right around the time of the solicitations when it was going to show up in the catalog. But DC had, and I think, the story was that Newsday, I believe, Newsday picked it up, and then they ran a story about news media, like the New York TV stations picked it up, and then it kind of just rolled. Nobody, DC Comics marketing people, they did not kind of grab, you know, the tail and held on when it when it took off. But crazy, we really didn't sell that many copies in the comic stores by relation and copies. And we were always trying to get the comic stores to care about the Superman books. I think that was a little bit of the issue, was that when the comic advanced publicity and it hit the, you know, the newsstands first, I mean, it was basically, I think that comic stores got comics, maybe was it still Fridays? I remember
it was Wednesdays, but still pretty much the new comic day was Wednesdays back then too.
Just remember that a lot of the comic stores were grabbing in copies. They were buying them at you know, cover price and reselling them because they just made demand.
Yeah, we just had a chat come up. Multilando 13 says, just wanted to say, as a Gen Z reader, I love Jerry Ordway's art so much and have just started Power of Shazam. That's a great, Larry and I were talking about that one too. Just got the hardcover edition from last year. So thank you, Multilando 13. We appreciate the chat. We are going to, by the way, for anyone listening, we're going to give away, I've got a polybagged copy of the 30th anniversary Death of Superman. Grabbed it from Larry's store when I was out there a couple weeks ago. So we'll be giving that away on the air. So if you would like to either send us a text on the KTRS text lines at 84126, just text us your name and where you're from. Like, this is Bob from Clayton, or this is Jenny from Chesterfield, and your comment or question for Jerry. Also, if like Multilanda 13, if you're watching us on YouTube or Facebook, you can leave it in the chat there where you're watching, and we'll take those, and at the end of the night, we'll draw a person's name to give away that polybagged edition. You can also call if you'd like. We do have open phone lines. KTRS tech line, our phone lines at 314-931-5877. It's interesting. I wonder, the 30th anniversary, it's the, you know, the death of issue that just came out, I guess it was November, it's last month, we're in December now. What was the process behind putting that together? They wanted all the heavy hitters back, you, and I know Dan Jurgens did some stuff for it. What was the process for getting that together? Did you have a meeting at DC to kind of figure out how you were going to run it? What was the process?
Actually, I think Dan Jurgens had initiated the project with DC saying, look, you guys always reprint this book. What if we did something with new material and work? But they also, weren't sure they were going to use us. They thought, well, we could, or whoever's under contract for DC, do it. And I think Dan kind of fought that it would be more of a tribute book if someone else did it.
Yeah.
Kind of a continuation of the stories. But I think I was contacted here And the editor, Brittany Holzer, she's basically spearheading the project. And she asked, you know, who do you want to work with? Like, to be able to work with Tom Grummett and Doug Hazelwood and Glenn Whitmore, because those were the, Glenn was the colorist, Doug Hazelwood was the inker, and Tom Grummett was the penciler. So I helped her reach out to some of the people, and we actually got our team together. We, you know, we left, or not we, but there were a couple of people left out of the mix. Was kind of unfortunate. I don't know who, if anybody was asked, or if it was just a case of, I know Dennis Janke wasn't part of it. I talked to Dennis around the time. He said he wasn't really interested, but I don't think DC officially asked him. Denny Rodier was the anchor on Action. I think Denny was left out too, but again, and I don't know the circumstances of it. I just know it's point of view. I wanted all the guys I worked with to, you know, on the book, and maybe of me asking for people specifically, maybe that opened the door for them. I don't know. I just feel like a reunion is a reunion. You don't want to leave anybody out, but
right,
you know, stuff happens, and maybe, you know, people at DC had lost contact with or whatever, maybe the you know, things could have been done differently. And but you know, we just started working on it, and I think Grummett started penciling pages back in June. Everything went smoothly. I didn't get to see anybody else's material until after I was done with mine, so it was kind of interesting to see what the other people had actually chosen to do. Dan's story, Dan Jurgens' story, is main, like I think it's the longest one. It's maybe 20 pages or something. And his story kind of occupies a couple of different spaces. Really interesting, because it had a little more contemporary and a little more flashback. But again, I was given 10 pages. I think Roger Stern, 10. You can't really do all. So I reread, you know, what I, the original death of story, but Ma and Pa Kent were like the emotional heart, and they really didn't get any original story, maybe a page per issue. And so an obvious one for me. It's maybe not the most dynamic thing, but I thought it was the start.
For those of us who like characterization, I thought it was a really nice story, Jerry. It's one of my favorite stories of the book.
We did, when we did the book, I mean, we tried to kind of make those side characters, and, you know, as real as could be within a comic, make you care about them, and kind of, though, it seemed like a natural.
Yeah. And we have another comment in the chat. David DeRose says, I remember grabbing issues from Reign of Superman from my local comic book store as a teen, realized I missed one. He turned right around and went back to hurry back and grab the other one. I'm just curious. We talked to Dan Jurgens, gosh, 4 years ago now, but one of the questions I asked him was Death of Superman stuff. From your standpoint, when you recollect back, there's four Superman books out. You had, obviously, Louise Simonson was working on Man of Steel. You know, you were working on Action and Adventure, if I'm not mistaken, at that time. Dan was doing some Superman stuff. What was the – how did the decision come around, let's kill Superman off, and the idea for the Doomsday character? Do you remember who contributed what facet to it?
Well, we always worked in a group, all kind of compile ideas, and then we come to up to – either to DC or to either have it at a remote location. But I think this one was done at DC's offices up and had, you know, sat around, came up with a bunch of ideas. We would at least 8 issues or 8 months worth of stories. And Mike put big pieces of paper up with grids on them for each, you know, like, because the books came one per ship week. So we had to have the stuff coordinated to a degree. So it was put a couple of lines, you know, in each box, what the subtle, just main story points. And we would come into the room, always did it. So at a certain point in a previous meeting or two, and all these charts are empty. And I thought, you know, we can't really. So I just said, I said to Mike, I said, go to the last chart. Superman died. And it was a way of just putting something up on the board. And everybody, they laughed. And I think that was the impetus for this, as I recall, was we started working on the idea, a big fight. And everybody was like, everybody, and the thing was, we didn't want to just do a fight for fight's sake. I was really that a lot of comic stories would have, you know, battles that always took place. And if we're actually going to do this, let's show it impact, you know, the people of Metropolis. Superman crashes through an apartment building. We want to be able to know that people are going to be homeless. There's going to be human consequence to that rather than just, you know. So we're back and forth in the room, and how is this going to be different? So they start talking about fight, and they're, you know, and people fighting, and the idea of like, oh, fight to the death. It was Carlin or Louise or somebody said, well, like Jerry always says, end. And it's like, but then what do we do? You know, so and a lot of it comes out of back and forth, just throwing stuff around on Doomsday. I think John Bogdanov, we were all talking about how you would introduce it. You do the page where Doomsday is always, he's been buried under the earth. And we do like this pounding rock as he's trying to breaking out, and over four issues would have one page of just that fist crash. And I think Bogdanov, boom, doom. And we were thinking, Walt Simonson did this, done this, Beta Ray Bill. And there was the sound effect of doom. It was going doom, doom. And when he hit the third doom, Carlin said, Doomsday. And we're like, okay, there we go. Oh, we got Doomsday for Superman. So the name out of a lot of that.
Hmm.
So we came up with the idea of, and that's as far as we were going to go. We had like what happens after. The main idea was we were going to take Superman away from the world, show how much people miss them. And this was like a double story in a way, flex the comic industry and the fact that in, you know, our quest to try to get the sales up, we were trying really hard to get the comic stores to care about Superman. And the comics, they care. We sold more copies on the newsstand. We sold, you know, like say 70,000 in the comic stores. And DC, of course, wanted more sales in the comic. And we would do one of the big storylines. We were really looking for attention, but we were also trying to show what good stories we were doing, because we were all proud of what we were working on. We took Superman away from everybody to make them understand how much he meant to them.
Yeah.
It worked in like a dual purpose way. So I think the fact that the news media picked up on it just amplified that aspect of like, how dare you take Superman away from us? When is he coming back? Is he coming back? So all that was quickly out of that storyline, which was to me the best way to have it happen, you know, rather than throwing a tremendous amount of money to promote it. They would never do that anyways. I mean, any comic that wasn't a number one issue, they had no promotional budget for launching a number one issue. So, you know, we were on our own trying to get interest by doing story. But yeah, it was interesting. And it was really a group. Everybody was in there. Glenn Whitmore, the inkers were in there. It was a big group. You had Mike, an editor, who I think was Dan Thorsland at the time. Mm-hmm. All this stuff had to be vetted. When we were finished, Mike had to take it to Jeanette Kahn. Like, can we do this? And to their credit, they signed off on it because you guys will make a good story out of it. But at the time, the other thing that's funny is in the, I guess, time, because at the time DC was doing a story with Batman getting his back broken. And I remember that being the one thing. I don't know if we can do this because we're already doing this big Bane story.
Right.
We're like, this has nothing about Batman. And this is Metropolis. You know, let us do our stories. So I have close enough together that at the time, that was the only comment. I didn't even remember if it was Jeanette or if it was Paul Levitz, but, you know, they...
I know, if I'm not mistaken, I think it was with the way the comic books came out in the market, and Larry, you can correct me if I'm wrong, I think it was Death of Superman. It was almost about 6 months later that we had the big Batman backbreaking issue, because you've got the Batman didn't show up in the fight because it was the Justice League at the time. Batman was not part of it. So you saw Booster Gold and Fire and Ice and Bloodwind and Blue Beetle fighting Doomsday, and I don't think Batman... showed up except at the funeral. He was kind of like perched up on the top of Metropolis, right, looking down. So it was a little bit, but the 90s were rough, man. We got Superman killed, Batman's back broken, Wonder Woman lost her title, Hal Jordan went insane. But that was some of the best comic books too.
What's that? Lost his hand.
That's right. Yeah, Aquaman lost his hand. But that was, some great. I remember in the 90s, I could not get enough of the DC comics at the time because that was just. You were changing all these characters around, and we still have, you know, the legacy of this. We're still dealing with John Henry Irons as Steel. He's still a superhero major player up there with Mr. Terrific and Batman in the DC universe.
Oh, Kyle Rayner's still around. And he's even in the new Lois and Clark show.
That's right. Yeah. In that as well. So, I mean, it's a lot of the legacy stuff. We did have a question in the chat as well. We've got David asked, he was curious of Jerry's thoughts on the animated adaptations of Superman Doomsday and Death Reign of Superman that came out in 2018.
I think there were, no one's going to do an exact, I mean, they can't do this, the stuff we book in a sense. It's kind of like when you read a Stephen King book or you like, when they do a movie of it, they cut all of the characterization in that book and it becomes about plot. So the Doomsday stuff is always by stripping the characterization and the extra, it just becomes a story about Superman dying and coming back. So I think and this newest one, because they had done it in the early 10 or 12 or something, maybe 2008.
Yeah, I think something like that.
I forget when they did, but the first one is a little bit more of Bruce Timm, and but it was a little more their version of it. This one felt like they were a closer adaptation, and they did have a couple little touches in there that were Bibbo is in there and gives his little speech about how, you know, why didn't take me, I'm just a broken down boxer, and you know, so that was I enjoy him, and there's not really much you can't look at it and go, oh, I can't believe they didn't do this, because all this stuff gets adapted, it's being adapted for a different medium, and they only have maybe at the most 70, 80 minutes.
Right.
But I have to say, I liked the second part better than the first. The second part, the Reign of the Superman, kind of even looked better. And I don't know why that, it feels like the actual, you know, the keyframe drawing the in some respect. And we saw both of them. I was lucky enough to be invited to a Directors Guild in New York City with all, and that was, I think, right before the Reign of the Superman came out, maybe before both of them. One of them came out, I think one of them, the Death had already come out, and the Rain was like the spring or something. So I got to see it on a movie screen, which was kind of fun too.
Yeah.
Which was interesting. But yeah, I think that whenever you expect that it's going to, they're going to do their own thing, because that's the history, you know, for another medium.
Yeah. I know we're talking tonight. I appreciate all the chats and everything that's come in right now. We're going to take a really quick commercial break. We're going to come back right after this, and we're going to chat more with Jerry Ordway. Again, if you have a question, you can give us a call at 314-931-5877. We'll watch the phones and try to get you on. Text your question on the KTRS text lines at 84126. If you're in the chat like David and like Multilanda 13, you can just send a chat through there, whatever podcast platform you're watching us on, and we'll get to that as well. We're going to take that quick break. We're going to come right back. You're listening to Geek to Me Radio on the Big 550 KTRS. Please stand by.
Sold separately. Some parts not for use with some toys. New from Mattel. Watch out! Beast Walker is coming! Can Trailblazer stop him? The ultimate battle coming soon. Enter the world of Voltron, where thrilling adventures let you soar beyond the limits of your imagination. Where the valiant Voltron force merges together in their robotic alliance to challenge the might of King Zarkon's demonic minions and menacing machines. You can join this never-ending battle between the army of evil and the champions of justice, with the fate of planet Arras and the entire universe at stake. Voltron action figures, lions, and vehicles, each sold separately from Panache Place.
Cobra can run, but he can't hide. The G.I. Joe Crusader is hot on his trail.
Nobody beats G.I. Joe, G.I. Joe Crusader. Cobra is shaking, shaking with fear. Crusader's gone blasting from the stratosphere.
Gotcha!
Launch the Avenger!
The Crusader and Avenger are one tough team.
Gear down!
Awesome!
Nobody beats G.I. Joe!
A real American hero!
Crusader comes with pilot and Avenger!
Yo-yo!
The Transformers! More than meets the eye! Autobots wage their battles and destroy the evil forces of the Decepticons! The Transformers! More than meets the eye! The Transformers! Robots in disguise!
Hi, this is George Newbern, the voice of Superman. You are listening to Geek to Me Radio.
Geek to Me Radio, heard here every Sunday on the Big 550 KTRS, 10 p.m. Eastern, 7 p.m. Pacific. It's appointment radio. Make sure you tune in so you don't miss when we've got live guests like the great Jerry Ordway on the show. Later on, next month. We're in December now. I got to get that through my head. I had a conversation with New York Times bestseller author Jeffrey Deaver. He wrote the Bond novel Carte Blanche. He's got a bunch of works you might have heard of, and he's got a brand new novel he's doing a tour from. He came through St. Louis, was very kind enough to do an interview, so we're going to be talking to Jeffrey Deaver. Dean Devlin, the creator of Leverage and The Librarians, we're going to have a conversation with him later this month. Next Sunday, we've got some special guests. We'll be talking about Star Wars Andor. We'll give our review of that show and a whole lot more to go. December has just started, and we've got a lot of great shows coming before the year ends. I want to make sure we tell you about our official premier sponsor, the City of St. Charles, the Greater St. Charles Convention and Visitors Bureau. Longtime listeners will know them from the website discoverst.com. They just completed their second weekend of Christmas traditions. This is the longest running and largest Christmas festival in the nation. They've got international gift givers from around the world, like La Befana, St. Nicholas. They've got international caroling groups that'll be around there. They'll singing different period songs. Chestnut people roasting chestnuts over an open fire and serving up cups of hot wassail. Jack Frost, Susie Snowflake are out there. It's a great time. It goes on all the way through Christmas Eve, I believe. They've got some special events coming up. December the 15th, you can have breakfast for dinner with Krampus. They actually have Krampus there and a lot of his mischief makers like the Cali Canceroy and the Mary Lloyd. You can sign up for that on the website, discoverstcharles.com. Have breakfast for dinner with Krampus. We got eggs. We got pancakes. There might be giant turkey legs. I don't know what Krampus eats. We'll see. No children on the menu, though, so it's a family-friendly and safe event. If you want to find out more, check out the website. Once again, discoverstcharles.com. As we always say, it's an historically good time. Chatting this show with Jerry Ordway, writer, artist, talking all about the 30th anniversary of the death of Superman. Again, if you want to win a polybagged copy of the 30th anniversary, we'll be giving that away later. Chris McQuillan just chimed in the chat and said, sweet! He's very excited that Jerry Ordway is on the show as well. We were talking during the break a little bit about some of the other stuff. Obviously, someone mentioned Power of Shazam, and I know Larry was saying before the show started that he said he was excited. This was the direction they wanted to see Captain Marvel slash Shazam go in. First of all, where do you stand? What is he called, Captain Marvel or Shazam? I always say the wizard Shazam. He's Captain Marvel. Let's hear from the man himself, Jerry Ordway. What are your thoughts on this?
Well, my thoughts are he's, but, you know, lawyers will tell you otherwise.
Very true, very true. That was a great book, and I remember picking that up, and I think DC just, was it, they just canceled it? Is that what happened? Were the numbers not there? What was the problem?
And it was successful, and at a certain point, Peter Cross and Pete was ready to move on after the third year. Because he was the opportunities to do other characters, and so he decided he wanted to leave. Said, "Well, I would like to keep it going, so I'll sign on to do another as well as write it." And what happened was, I plotted it out through issue 50, and where I was going. I wanted to get to issue 50 because the very first Marvel comic was Spider-Man number 50 with Spider-Man walking away from his costume in the garbage can and Parker, yeah. I should say. So it was like a childhood thing to get to issue 50. On issue 44, 45, I guess around 44, I had been drawing issues. I got a call from my editor and he said, send the book because they feel like you'd be better used elsewhere. So they had ideas else. And I was like, well, I don't really want to, you know, I want to do Shazam. And they said, well, I just started a storyline where Billy Batson and Mary and Freddie Freeman all got in an accident. So I'm like, I can't wrap this up right away. When they wanted to shut it down, we were selling pretty runaway success, but we were selling in the top say 60%, and it was profitable. It was selling like maybe 40,000 copies at the time. And DC did something stupid, is they went to Wizard Con and they told Wizard that the book was canceled. And this was in like of 98. And the comic was scheduled to go through issue 47, technically. And issue 42 had just come out, or 43. Orders for all of those after that, it's all people just rats jumping off the ship for the last six issues. They just, because everybody, they knew it was canceled, you know. If they had just, I never understood that. I don't understand what business sense it may announce something that early,
yeah,
when you know it's going to kill the sale. So it was like their own self-fulfilling prophecy. The book, it's the longest run that should, you know, a gazillion years. And there were a lot of fans. There, people even were trying to, they said, hey, can we write in and make, you know, once DC had it in their mind to cancel it was done. So and ultimately, you know, I felt cheated out of getting it to issue 50.
Sure.
You know, but it, you know, everybody remembers over the, you know, years, whenever people kind of get into Captain, eventually wind up finding back issues of Power of Shazam, and they're like, wow, this book is great. And, but, you know, we did have a decent audience. We just, you know, you have to remember, as a comic, it was never a million seller for DC. It was a million publications. So I think it always felt like he was the adopted child. He didn't really own it until 1978 or something, that they bought it out. I don't remember. So the successes it had were with a different company. It had that feeling towards it, like they do with Wonder Woman or Flash, where they, whether it sells poorly or sells halfway decent, you know, there's keeping something in print. I'd hoped that they would just, you know, just relaunch it, but keep it going with a different, even different, smarter. Because once you go off the boards, you know, you go dark, a thread to maybe a generation of comic readers.
Yeah.
You know, and to think about it, that was the last issue I did, came out in 1999, and didn't have its own series. It had a couple of mini series. I think Judd Winnick had done something.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was in JSA for a little bit. So I think that hurts the characters, because, you know, you could be the biggest character ever, but Phantom, or maybe not the Phantom, but like the Lone Ranger, or you know, some of these wind up disappearing.
Mm-hmm.
They have, you know, your grand members, it being a great comic book or a popular thing, but it's lost a thread with so many. I think that's, you know, that's what keeps Superman and Wonder Woman, Batman. Every generation has a Superman, Batman, or Wonder Woman.
It's interesting. I mean, I say this as a DC guy. Like I said, I'm wearing my Star Lab shirt and everything. But the fact you said DC did something stupid could almost be their business model in the last couple of years, I feel. But that's just me. No disrespect, man. But
not just that company, though.
No, yeah, Marvel's done some funny business too that I don't always get. But it's one of those, like, the thing that drives me crazy. I know I've talked with you about this, Larry. Is they got the legacy numbers for Marvel, but they keep renumbering, like Iron Man that Christopher Cantwell was just doing. They got to issue 25. Guess what? We're relaunching the book. No, I don't want to buy a number one. Like Jerry was saying, number ones always sell, but that drives me crazy, because then I've got all my tabs in my collection.
Yeah.
Invincible Iron Man, you know, Superior Iron Man. I've got to go through and renumber everything. It's just, it's maddening. But I'm going off on a tangent. I don't mean to. We talked a little bit too, Jerry. Actually, tell you what, 9:37, man, this hour's flying by. Let me take another quick break. We're going to come back. We're going to talk with Jerry about Stargirl and about Zachary Levi's casting as Shazam in the movie that came out. And then we'll talk a little Black Adam, because I know you saw it with Mitch Halleck. So we'll talk about that as well. We're taking this quick break. We'll be right back. You're listening to Geek to Me Radio on the Big 550 KTRS. Please stand by.
Wasn't there a road here?
Not anymore, Dad!
Hot Wheels USA Builder Set. Not for use with Hot Wheels Hauler. Hot Wheels cars sold separately. New from Mattel.
The Legoland Vader 1 Command Base. You build it for action. You can pretend the radar sounds an alert, a signal to the crew. So you slide them to the launch pad for a make-believe rescue. And how about the new mobile rocket transport? You can drive it over make-believe craters, then get ready for flight. You can lower the rocket, pretend to fire, and blast it out of sight.
The action's up to you.
The new Legoland Mobile Rocket Transport from the Legoland Collection. Legoland Vader 1 Command Base sold separately from LEGO Systems.
Light bright, light bright, turn on the magic of colored lights. Light bright, light bright, make a face to glow at night. Smiling friends, shining.
This segment brought to you by our official movie sponsor, Marcus Theaters. MarcusTheaters.com is the website where you can go to find the Marcus Theaters and the movie tavern located closest to you. It's a great time to see movies. We just saw Violent Night. We had a press screening earlier in the week. I took a big group with my Christmas traditions friends to go see it Friday night because it was that good. I wanted to see it again. David Harbour as Santa Claus. If you go to geekmeradio.com, you can see my review. I kind of described it as Miracle on 34th Street meets John Wick with just a splash of Die Hard and a touch of Home Alone. It was so much fun. David Harbour was obviously having a blast. Beverly D'Angelo as the power-hungry matriarch of the family. Great cast. John Leguizamo is as great as Mr. Scrooge, the villain, as his code name. But it's a good movie. It whiplashes you between heartwarming with the family and the little girl who just wants her parents to go back together to, oh my gosh, he just put a candy cane through that guy's eye. It's a great film, though. If you're looking to have a good time at Christmas, go check out Violent Night. But there's a lot of great movies. You can see Black Adam still in theaters as well. You can see the new Tom Hanks movie that's coming out. You can buy your tickets now for that online. If you haven't seen Wakanda Forever yet, that's still playing. Get out and see a movie. Movie theaters are something I missed during COVID, so I'm so glad they're back. Best place to do it is at Marcus Theaters. MarcusTheaters.com is the website. As we always say, it's the best movie-going experience in the galaxy. Talking about movies, we were talking about Power Shazam with Jerry Ordway, writer, artist, of many a DC comic and Marvel comic, all the stuff you've worked on. What were your thoughts on Zachary Levi cast as Shazam?
I like the idea of it. I had Chuck, the TV show, yeah. Chuck, and when I heard it was good casting, and I liked the movie a lot. I thought the first movie, you know, I mean, that's kind of what I was hoping for.
Mm-hmm.
Just like, I guess, again, everything is, you're not only for a different medium, but you're adapting a comic book character for what's happening today.
Mm-hmm.
So I mean, that always definitely affects, I think, the move 6 years from start to getting something on the screen, and you have to, you know, you have to kind of latch on to a hook, basically. And even, I mean, really, when Tom Hanks' movie Big came out, then the industry, they kept going, wow, that's the way to do Captain Marvel, you know.
Yeah,
Shazam.
That's interesting. Yeah.
And ultimately, that's kind of what they did. You know what I mean? They did. I thought it was successful. I enjoyed it.
And how about Black Adam? What were your thoughts on that one?
I was really excited, mostly to see the JSA, because I thought that I saw in the trailer looked really cool. I was a little disappointed. I think it's certainly not boring. It's all action. I was expecting a characterization or a little bit more something, you know. It felt like the for anybody who hasn't seen it, I mean, I would say go see it. It's not something that you'd go, oh my God, what do they do? It's fun. It's entertaining a little more, you know?
And I know Stargirl, because I loved All-Star Squadron that you and Roy Thomas worked on. And we had Roy Thomas on the show. It's probably been a year ago now, but he said All-Star Squadron was one of his personal favorite projects that he got to do. And you were a big part of that too. So what are your thoughts on Stargirl and their JSA?
I'm amazed to see them do such obscure characters. I enjoyed it. Stargirl, again, each of the seasons has been slightly different, but I've really enjoyed all really good. And I'm surprised, again, that they've managed to slip in the Infinity Inc. stuff mm-hmm. into that, you know, as a TV show. They have, I mean, that's a fun aspect that you know, no one's afraid of using the costumes.
Yeah.
Say those characters are, you know, from the 1940s, they're challenging to do in live action. But it's fun to see that, you know. Yeah, no, I think I'm sad that they aren't getting a fourth season, you know.
Yeah.
I kind of feel like I know where they were headed. And they had a perfect Stargirl. They had a really good cast all around. But it all comes down to somebody looking at numbers. There's no doubt,
you know,
whether it's stone or if they want it to be more successful or they, you know, the, maybe the better with a game show. I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah, it's, the cast is great. I love everything they've done. That's one of those ones that I saw. A lot of times, season one is a show where they got to find their footing. And, you know, like Seinfeld, great TV show. First two seasons were a little rough. But I felt like Stargirl, they locked in on that first season and just blew it out of the water. I really thought it was really well done.
Well, when it first debuted, I reached out to Jeff Johns because I... personal to him, and I told him how much I enjoyed it and kind of shared that he wanted to because he was a showrunner and he actually moved his family to Atlanta to be there for the, you know, he felt like that was important because you can write your scripts and if you're miles away you don't make the decisions as stuff is getting filmed, and he didn't really let somebody else make last minute decisions for him. So that aspect shows that it has a little bit of a different feel than the other CW. I think a little bit more something. I don't know. The CW shows is that they were successful. They did an awful lot of them. And I think at a certain, they maybe are a little formulaic because people are setting them up and they're, you know, they write a whole season, like with the other shows, they write the whole season out.
Yeah.
And then they, you know, special effects and stunts and things like that. And once you kind of get that rhythm, I'm sure that a lot of that is dictated before and dictated almost like there becomes a little bit of a sameness because they might have on the same, you know, studio sets or whatever, where it was in Atlanta. I think Black Lightning was filmed in Atlanta as well. And I think that can be a little different because it's got different personnel, maybe less expectations or whatever. But yeah, I think, you know, I haven't, Jeff had tweeted a picture of, Stargirl in costume with the, Teen Titans, on this in Toronto or wherever they shoot Titans. Mm-hmm. So it made me wonder if she filmed a cameo, that's a way to continue by having her. And, you know, join the Titans.
Yeah. Yeah. That would
Which
be cool.
More adult.
Yeah. I mean, she'd have to grow up pretty quick because she seems very innocent. And Titans is a little rough on the
pretty intense.
Yeah. Exactly. That'd be something to see for sure. A little bit of, we talked about Whiplash with Violent Night. My goodness. I did like the show. We had Eric Goins, the gambler, on, and we had, I can't think of the gentleman's name who plays Sportsmaster on the show. And it seems like the actors say it's the best show to work on. They're having a ball. But to your point, I think that while it's sad they're going out with season three, some of those shows do over. I feel like The Flash could have stopped two or three seasons ago because, like you said, it does get a little formulaic. It's almost like they've run out of ideas. So at least with Stargirl, we've got that, you know, they're going out in their own terms. It's three seasons, and they're going to end with the people wanting more.
Well, you know, I don't think it's that they run out of ideas. I do think it's that they're basically, a show has got to be a little bit like a, you know, a circus or something. And you of doing it, you know, season after season, you fall into a little bit of a rut. Scripts that are interesting, you're going to execute them because production. I mean, you've got lots of people working on it. It's not just a writer and a director, and it's a huge production. And I think that's the problem, is that they budget everything, never get as much money as they need to do the shows, so they can write big. You know, I was so surprised when they did the Crisis thing on the CW, because I thought on their budget, but they actually actually did a good job.
I agree.
They more than I thought they would. They attempted more than I ever thought they would. But a shame in a way to see all that stuff go, because I don't think, well, the only show going to be on after this is the Superman and Lois is the only one that's been ahead of its debut.
Yeah,
it's,
I think so.
Renewed for.
Yeah, it sounds about right. Yeah, I believe so. Because obviously Batwoman was canceled already. And I was enjoying Legends of Tomorrow. I thought it was fun, quirky. It felt like a very much, I almost felt like Giffen and DeMatteis were writing the scripts at sometimes, because it was very much in that Justice League International type of vein that they were going with. That was a fun show.
Well, it's like they threw everything against the wall to see what would stick. You know, they didn't.
Yeah.
Happen on that show.
Yeah, very much so. And we were just about to get Booster Gold. Michael Faison, for crying out loud, is Booster Gold. That would have been brilliant to see. But unfortunately, I know Jess McKellen was talking to us at Planet Comic Con, and she said, yeah, unfortunately, it's just, you know, it's up to the fates, and they didn't get renewed, unfortunately. We're coming up in the last 10 minutes. Jerry, I appreciate your time. I don't want to keep you any longer. Is there anything else you want to talk about, anything you're working on that you can share with listeners if they want to see something you got coming out soon, or just conventions you'll be doing in the coming year?
I would like to promote a few things. One is that I continue a couple of pages. I did a page and a half in JSA number one.
Oh, cool.
Which came out, and I'm working on I got 4 pages in JSA number 2. Don's is clearly, I guess I'm being brought in as kind of a lucky charm. Hopefully it works. It's fun to draw the Golden Age characters again. I'm doing, you know, JSA. That's been a kind of a thrill. I also am doing, I did a Stan Lee celebration of Stan's 100th birthday with DC Universe characters. That comes out, I guess, towards Christmas. It's special. And I did a Star Wars cover first.
Oh, cool.
On Solo and Chewbacca number 8. It's a variant cover. And on a cover for the Mandalorian comics. So it's kind of fun for a challenge. So I'm a big original Star Wars fan. Liked a lot. A lot of the stuff. I've watched stuff with my kids too, so you have a different perspective. But that's been kind of fun lately, and I still trying to find time to do a Proton comic that I usually sell. I try to get stuff to sell at the. Also working with Tom Grummet on, I'm helping out Carl Kiesel Kickstarter from a couple of years ago. Section 0, 19 pages of Tom Grummet for, because Carl's been having a harder time getting time to ink stuff. I'm keeping busy.
It sounds like it. And you're always a fixture at Terrificon. It's always great to see you at Mitch's show, which, for my money, I've told Larry this before, hands down, probably top 4 conventions for me in the country is Terrificon. And I assume you'll be there again in 2023.
God willing, I will be there. It's like get hit by lightning and I don't turn into Captain Marvel.
But I wouldn't. If that happens, I wouldn't blame you. You can always come to St. Louis and be live in the studio with us, though, if you can fly like Captain Marvel does. So keep that in mind. The invitation's always open there. And I'll have Larry hold that Han Solo cover, because I'll bring that with me to have you sign at TerrificCon when I see you in, I think it's July this year, TerrificCon. But if you want to keep up with them online, it's at Jerry Ordway, very easy on Twitter. Websites, are you active on other social media as well at the moment?
Not too much. Most.
All right, and we'll keep up with them there on Twitter then. Absolutely delighted to have you on. Thank you very, very much for your time on a Sunday evening. I know you're on the East Coast and it's an hour later, so I appreciate it. And hopefully we'll talk to you again very soon. Happy belated birthday. I wished you on Twitter, but it's my first time speaking with you, so happy belated birthday as well.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Of course, anytime. There he goes, Jerry Ordway, creator, writer, artist. Keep up with him online, because it's always brilliant to see his works that he puts up on Twitter. And if you get a chance to meet him in person, I highly recommend you do. And we'll be checking out those books. I think Larry has been writing down the ones he said, so we'll be he'll have those pulled for me at the store. We're going to take our very last commercial break. We're going to come back. We're going to wrap things up. Larry and I will be talking a little bit, too, about the death of Superman and some other stuff going on, what's going on at the local comic book stores. All that and more. You're listening to Geek to Me Radio on the Big 550 KTRS. Please stand by.
Light Bright from Milton Bradley.
Secret is revealed when innocent-looking vehicles and ordinary men become an awesome fighting team. It's the secret of Mask, where illusion is the ultimate weapon.
Go under the microfilm.
Mask vehicles, each sold separately with action figures.
That doesn't stop me.
Switchblade attacks.
Wings out.
Rhino retaliates. Shadow creates a diversion. Rhino reveals its hidden firepower.
Gotcha.
Mask, where illusion is the ultimate weapon.
The Micro Machine Man here, presenting the genuine original, colossally collectible, most midget miniature replicas of the real things. Micro Machines. Dramatically detailed, stupendously styled, smaller than a nut, this one or this one. And now with a totally terrific town, the new Micro Machine Super City Toolbox playset. Closed, it's a mild-mannered toolbox. Open, it's a Micro Machine USA. Cruise your mini Micro Machine vehicles, planes, and boats to the police station, the marina, the mini motorcycle repair shop, the gas station, the construction office, work, the real working drawbridge, highway, passenger ramp, and garage doors. Or take a Micro Machine flying machine in for a landing. Phew, this place has it all. The new Micro Machine Super City Toolbox playset from Galoo. The one and only outrageous original miniatures. Remember, if it doesn't say Micro Machines, it's not the real.
It's Wampa Cave. Luke's inside. We better get him out. Arg,
arg. Wampa!
Introducing Hoth World. Three play sets in one. New from Star Wars Micro Collection line. 19 die-cast figures and action poses included.
Wow, they're small enough to fit in one hand.
Yeah, pow!
So much for Probot Spy. It's safe, Chewie.
Arg, arg!
We can get back to Hoth Iron Cannon.
Hey, it connects to Hoth Wampa Cave.
Han's here!
Close blast doors.
Raise Rebel Soldier in observation
time. And you're listening to Geek to Me Radio. Stay wound.
Welcome back. Geek to Me Radio on the Big 550 KTRS. Hopefully, if you're watching online tonight, that's thanks to Joey V in studio helping me set up the video again. Thanks to Jerry Ordway for being on the air. It's always great to talk to these legendary creators who have done so much work. 30th anniversary of the death of Superman. Who would have believed it? If you are looking to get that comic, or if you're looking to get a new comic in general, Bugs Comics and Games on Bryan Road in O'Fallon, Missouri, bugscomicsandgames.com is the website. If you're outside the greater St. Louis, St. Charles area and you're looking for a new comic book store, maybe your local comic book store closed down, Larry and Tim can be your new local comic book store, but online. Go to the website. You can get variant covers. They're always updating it with new issues. They're buying. I was just in the store Thursday, I guess, and Larry was going through a bunch of new comics. He just got a new collection in, was putting some out, so there's always something new you'll find. And, of course, join the Avengers Club. In this economy, save some money. Join the Avengers Club. Start saving money on your new issues, your back issues, your toys, your games, your supplies, all that good stuff. That way you don't have to give up your hobby. You can still save money and keep your hobby going at the same time. Like, give them a like on Facebook as well, Bugs Comics and Games on Facebook. And, of course, check out their store if you're local. Right there off of Bryan Road. You can get it from Highway 70 or from the Page Extension. Just go right there to Bryan Road, and they're right there by the Quick Trip. You can fill up with gas after you leave, and it's just a one-stop shop. BugsComicsAndGames.com. Very glad to have them as our official comic book sponsor. We've got the owner, Larry Quiggins, here in studio. It's always great to talk to people like Jerry because you find out some of that stuff I did not know about how they – oh, that's how he came up with the name Doomsday. That's not something Dan told me previously, so I'm always learning something new.
That's probably because – well, the way he said it – didn't he say it was Louise who coined it?
Yeah, I think so. Because
so
it was
Louise Simonson.
Walt.
So that's probably why Juergens wasn't thinking about it, because he wasn't the one who actually came up with, threw it out there.
Yeah.
And he probably didn't want to say anything and forget exactly who was the one who said it. You know, we got to be careful about that, too. We could have said that, you know, Ordway said it, and then he'd come around and Louise call him, hey, I'm the one who said that.
Giffen and DeMatteis can never agree on, they always say the other person came up with the blah-ha-ha for Justice League.
Right.
No, that was Keith. No, that wasn't me.
Somebody did, though.
Right, exactly. We've just got about 40 seconds left. I know your eyes kind of lit up when he mentioned the Stan Lee special. I guess that's something you'll have
that's
in stock at the store as well.
That's the Just Imagines that Stan Lee did for DC, and he did he reimagined all of the main
Superman,
characters,
Batman,
and
yeah.
I really enjoyed the line. Yeah. Of course, I'm a Stan Lee fan, so that's
probably not
the best to say, but that I did. But they're doing a revisit to it and a celebration of it, and I noticed that Ordway, because Jerry did the Superman one with him.
Okay. Yeah, that's right. That's right. Yeah, that was...
And it was a great book.
I've got that Just Imagine, the big poster, because I collect the posters and get them signed, and Stan Lee signed it for me before he passed, so I've got his signature.
Excellent.
I still got to get a few other people on there. But it's, Jim Lee is a hard
There's
nut
a
to
lot
crack.
Of people who worked on those books with
Oh,
him.
Yeah. Absolutely. A lot of people, a lot of good talent. So that'll be cool. So you can get those at Bugs Comics and Games in O'Fallon, Missouri as well. The time has flown by. I'm playing the outro music right now. Thanks again to Jerry Ordway. Thanks to Larry of Bugs Comics for coming in studio.
Thanks for having me.
Thanks to you, the listener, for checking us out. I'm going to draw a name here. We got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 people. So stay tuned. Follow us on Facebook and Twitter. We're also doing a big toy giveaway for Christmas with our partners at Kokomo Toys in Kokomo, Indiana. So if you're following me on Twitter, you have a chance to win a ginormous box of toys shipped to your house just before Christmas. So for that geek in your life who might like some cool stuff, I'm adding some stuff from my personal collection as well, some comic books, a Funko Pop or two. It's going to be a really cool prize. At Geek to Me Radio on Twitter. Check us out on Instagram as well at Geek to Me Radio. Max on Movies up next. Brooke Shields is his guest. That's amazing. So check out Max on Movies. Violent Night review as well from him. Thank you, as always, to Joey B for making the show look and sound as good as it does. Until next week, my friends. That's a show. This is Geek to Me Radio. Thank you, Smallville. Good night.
KTRS.
A long slide downward. The oil-producing nations of the OPEC cartel met today